chapter 21 talks about something called incremental analysis, or another word for that is differential analysis. And it sounds kind of fancy, but really all it means is we're going to look at two different choices that a manager or a company might be looking at and see what the difference is between those two to help us make the determination about which of those two choices we should take. So the mathematical calculation of it is pretty easy. It's really just two columns and we look at the differences. So that's one of the reasons you're seeing the PowerPoint slides here. They've already got the columns set up for the examples in the chapter, so it's easier for me to talk through the examples instead of having to try to write them up. It's also neater if you're seeing it on the slide. So the calculations themselves are pretty straightforward. The tricky part, of course, is trying to get the right words or right words turned into the right numbers to put into the spreadsheets. So that's what we're going to be talking about. We're actually going to be looking at really five different situations that are situations where we're going to compare two different alternatives and then try to figure out which one increases the profit the most or also gives us the greatest benefit. So these are pretty common types of analysis that managers are going to be doing. Now, the first objective that we talk about in learning objective on page 974 is we actually talk about the decision-making process. And if you've had introduction to business or introduction to management, you've probably heard about this, where there's a decision-making process model. Really, all it says is managers have to go through and they're asked to make a decision. They should go through a logical sequence. Most of us do this already, we just don't think about it. But there's four steps. The first one is to go through and identify the problem or question that needs to be answered. Should I offer product A or product B? Should we keep the old machine or should we pay the money to replace it with a new machine? Those are the kinds of questions that come up all the time in the business community and in life in general. So the first step is just to identify and make sure you know what the question is you're trying to resolve. The second step is where we go through now and we look at the different choices that are available to us and we evaluate them. And when we do that, we want to look at ways of measuring either quantitatively with numbers or qualitatively looking at the impact that those changes might have. So we kind of do a pros and cons, if you will, of the different choices. And then based upon that, we rank the choices and then we go through our third step, which is to then make a decision. We pick choice A, choice B, or choice C. Maybe we say, okay, we pick choice B because we think that gives us the greatest number of benefits and the least number of negatives. And then finally, a lot of companies, the managers stop there because, you know, then you're busy and you go on to the next crisis and you try to resolve that. But there really should be a fourth step, which is where you go through and you actually review and look at what your choice was here later on to see if it turned out to be the best choice. Now, why do we do that? Well, that's how you learn to become better decision makers. If you make a choice and then at some point you step back and evaluate the results, if it was good, then you know that your decision-making process that you followed over here and in defining the problem was effective. But if you get over here and you find that choice didn't turn out to be the best choice or didn't work like you planned, then you can evaluate and say, why did it not work? And that can help you then make better choices later on and evaluate your choices. So this feedback that we get helps us to go through and to be better decision-makers in the future. So why does this all have to do with accounting? Well, the role of this chapter and management accounting in general is to help managers make better choices by looking at the quantitative or the number side of these different alternatives or choices and letting people see what the financial impact to the net income will be for the different choices. It's just one piece of the information that managers need, but it is an important component. So what we're going to be talking about in those five scenarios are all about comparing two different choices and seeing what the impact of increasing or decreasing the profitability or net income of the company will be. Okay. Keep in mind that when a business manager, and this is not just accounting managers, this is all business managers, marketing, the management, the CEO, the small business owner, they all have to go through and make decisions. They're going to base that information upon the financial numbers. How much is it going to cost me? What's it going to do to sales? What's it going to do to expenses? Expenses going to go up? And what's my net effect on the profitability? And then also the non-financial information. Because sometimes you'll have a decision that might make sense from the number standpoint financially, but it may have a bigger cost. One of the things we'll talk about is make or buy decisions. Well, if you buy something, you're basically outsourcing some of your resources, some of your production. If that's the case, you may either lay off people or not need to hire more people. Well, that can have a big impact upon employee morale. You know, having layoffs can make people who lose their job, obviously affects their quality of life, but even the people who remain are then more worried about their future with the company. So that affects morale. So we need to keep in mind that the non-financial information needs to be calculated just as much. I know this is an accounting class, so we sometimes feel it's all about numbers, but the qualitative side is just as important. And that can be things like control over things like the company's quality control, the customer experience and customer satisfaction, the employees. There's a lot of issues that are qualitative that need to be factored into some of the decisions we're going to talk about, along with just the financial numbers side.
Okay.
So with that in mind, the whole thing about incremental analysis is simply we're going to look at the differences between revenues and expenses and net income. In some cases, maybe only revenues will change. In some cases, maybe only the expenses will change between the two choices. In some cases, they'll both change. But the bottom line is we want to go through and see what the impact is going to be on the income. Now, here's what this looks like, and this is why it's, from a math standpoint, it's pretty simple. When we're doing differential or incremental analysis, we're really just doing two things. We're listing the revenues and costs and then the effect on the net income of the changes we're going to make. And then we just go through and list the alternative, what's going to happen, what are the revenues and costs and net income going to be from alternative or first choice A. And then what are the alternatives going to be, the impact for revenues and costs and net income on alternative B. So we're just saying if we did A, this is what will happen. If we did B, this is what's going to happen. And then we just take the difference. And we see that that difference is going to increase net income with a positive, decrease it with a negative, and then what the bottom line income is, the net effect is the net income. So it's really a very simple process. It's just making sure we know how to put in the right information about the changes. That's where kind of the trick comes in. And that's just comes from walking through and understanding the examples. But the process itself is very straightforward. You can do it real easily on an Excel spreadsheet. Okay? So in this particular case, alternative A generates a higher revenue. Okay, say this is our base case. This is what we're doing now. We're generating $125,000 in revenues. Alternative B is going to lower our revenues. So if you're just focused on the revenues, you say, well, we shouldn't do B because revenues are going to go down. But the other part of it is costs are going to go down from $100,000 to $80,000. And because the costs go down $20,000, which is more than the reduction in revenues, alternative B is going to actually increase our net income by $5,000, even though the sales might be going down. So that's why it's important to not just look at one component, revenue or expenses. You need to look at both of those if they're going to change and see what the net effect is going to be on net income. So that's basically, in a nutshell, differential or incremental analysis.
Okay.
Now, what are the costs that we're looking at when we're comparing between the two alternatives? Well, there's some terms they talk about, and they have this on page 975. There's something called relevant costs. And relevant costs really is any sort of cost that changes or it's relevant between the two choices. It's going to have an impact upon us. So if a cost goes up or down between the choices, it's relevant. That includes revenues. You can also have relevant revenues. You know? If under one alternative we have revenues of $100,000 and under the other alternative we have revenues of $120,000, revenues went up, that's relevant. It's something we would want to know to help us make the decision. The other side of that is we have, they don't put it up here, but we have things that are not relevant or non-relevant. And those are expenses or revenues that don't change. If I have an expense under option A that's $5,000 and an option under, same expense under option B is also $5,000, doesn't change between the two, it's not going to affect my decision. So it's not relevant. So I probably don't need to put it in the analysis. We only want to put in the analysis those items that change that are relevant. So that's what relevant costs are. Opportunity cost refers to the cost of not doing something. And so sometimes if we, for example, make a change, that's going to free up some time or capacity. We could do something else that might generate additional revenue. Well, there's two ways we can do it. We can either show it as an increase in revenue for option B, or the way this book does it, it says, well, if we do A, we're not going to get that additional revenue, so that's a cost of keeping choice A. So we put that as an expense or opportunity cost on the analysis where the event did not occur. And you'll see this as we walk through some of the examples. So that one gets a little tricky. In the real world, you could either put it as an increase revenue for A, or you could put it as an increased cost, opportunity cost for B, an increase in the revenue for B, because if that's where it happens, or you could put it as an opportunity cost increase for A, because you're not going to get that revenue. The book chooses the option where you put it as a cost where you're not going to get the revenue. And then the last item talks about sunk costs. And sunk costs are things that have already happened in the past and really don't affect our decision here. So we kind of ignore them. Now it gets to be a little tricky because, you know, sometimes, usually it has to do with the equipment. You've already spent some money for equipment. So let's say you go through and 3 years ago you paid $100,000 for a new piece of equipment. And it's supposed to last for 5 years. So now you go through and now you're talking about getting a new piece of equipment because it's more efficient, it's going to be more energy efficient, it's going to save you money on operating costs, it's going to be faster, so it's going to let you run more production. And you're going, oh yeah, you know, I really should get this new machine, but that old machine is still running fine. It's still good. I don't want to lose out on that old machine. Well, the idea is you really shouldn't focus on that because you've already spent that money 3 years ago. And the $125,000 or whatever is left shouldn't be a factor in your decision. Your decision should just be on the cost of savings and the additional revenue you're going to get going forward under both choices. So in that situation, you would ignore that old machine. The only thing you would put in there is if you could sell the old machine for money after you got the new one, then that, of course, would be cash that's coming in. You put that in. But the fact that you have the old machine really doesn't shouldn't affect your financial analysis. So again, we'll see some examples of that in that last bullet point that we have for our learning objectives. So those are sunk costs. They've happened in the past, and so we're going to kind of ignore them because they're no longer relevant to our decision-making process. So with that in mind, let's start going through and talking about how we're going to analyze these things. There's five different categories we're going to look at. We're going to look at if you have a chance to make some more product, but you're going to sell it at a special price, which is lower than your normal price. Should you do that or should you not? Should you make products in-house or should you outsource them and buy them from somebody else? That's a decision. If you're making products and you have a choice of either stopping your production and selling it at an interim stage or producing it and making it more refined and selling it for a higher price, should you sell it at the interim stage or should you refine it and spend more money and sell it at the higher price, which makes the most sense from a profitability standpoint. The one we just talked about, should you repair, retain, or replace equipment? So we'll look at the differences on that. And then finally, the last one is if you have an unprofitable business segment or market or store or division, should you keep it or should you close it? And sometimes the answer is you don't save as much money as you think if you just close it and it's unprofitable. So we're going to go through these examples, all right? Now, each one of these is going to be a learning objective. One of the things I'd suggest in the book is at the end of every one of these learning objectives, they've got this do it section. And I'm not going to go through these, but I think these are a really good way for you to go back and review each of the different learning objectives. Because when you get to the exam, you're going to have all these little scenarios where I'm going to ask you to calculate something based upon this one and this, and calculate, you know, what the incremental analysis is on buying or selling or replacing equipment, and you know, do a calculation on the profitability of a division. So if I pick those things, you're going to have to do a calculation. It's easy to do the numbers. It's hard to know sometimes which one of those little scenarios you're trying to do. So if you walk through these do-its, they kind of give you a little bit more of a background in addition to the homework. They help you kind of understand how the mechanics of each of these steps take place. And more importantly, by reading the words, you're able to learn how to take the words and put them into the schedule. Because honestly, this chapter, just like chapter 20, it's really just all about word problems. It's reading what's going on and then knowing how to take the information that's in words and put it into, in 20, the right formula, here into the right column for the right analysis. So the more you can practice reading the words and seeing how they get put into a schedule like this, the better off you'll be when you come to the test. So I'm not going to walk through these, but I would encourage you to go back and look at the do-it exercises at the end of every one of the learning objectives. And that holds for all the chapters, 20 and even 19, okay? But especially in this one in chapter 20. All right, so we're not going to do these. Let's skip over that. So the first one we're going to do is learning objective 2, accepting an order at a special price. Now in this case, what we're doing is basically somebody's coming in and saying, hey, I'll buy your product. Maybe you're making a product. It's usually the way it works. You're manufacturing, and somebody comes in and says, I will buy your product, but I want you to give me a discount. I want to get a lower price than you're giving everybody else. Now why would you do that? Well, there's two situations you need to keep in mind if that comes up. First off, you're only going to do that if you're not operating at full capacity. In other words, your factory and your people aren't working, making as many as you can sell. If you can sell as many as you can make, you're not going to let somebody have a discount. You're going to keep making them and selling them at the full price. But if you have people that could be making more, you might think, well, I'm not going to get my full price, but at least I'll get something. So that would be the case. So you're only going to do this if you're not operating at full capacity. You have excess capacity available. The second thing, and this is important, you're only going to do this if by giving one company a discounted price, it's not going to mess up the price you're selling your product to all your other companies, your customers. Because you don't want to have a situation where you give one company a discount and all your other customers find out about it, then they're going to start demanding the discount as well. So you want to be careful not to go through. We make the assumption that the selling this special order at a discounted price does not affect the selling price for all the regular selling price for all your other customers. That's in the real world a big assumption because word gets out when you're given discounts. But in our calculation, that's one of the assumptions we make. So just keep that in mind. The company's not operating at full capacity, and we assume that the sale of the product at the discounted price does not affect your other markets that you're selling at a regular price. Okay. So they go through and they give us this big word problem up here. So we have the company, Sunbelt, and this is over on page, all this narrative is over on page 979, it looks like. So you're going through and you have a company, oh, nope, that's objective three, I jumped ahead. It's over on page 978. You have a company, Sunbelt, and they make 100,000 smoothie blenders per month, all right? Now they're running at 80% of plant capacity, so they could make more smoothie blenders. But right now they're making 100,000. And then they give you some costs. They tell you the variable manufacturing cost is $8 to make a blender. They also tell you your fixed manufacturing cost is $400,000 and they're $4 per unit. Now, you always want to pay attention to the fixed costs on these analyses because that's usually where your differences are going to start to pop up. Think about it. Your fixed costs are going to stay fixed no matter how many you make. So just because we said it's $4 per unit, that's just at that level of production. If you make more, your fixed costs are going to change, right? Because remember, fixed costs on a per unit basis go up and down with the production. So the problem, though, is if you think about it, in total, fixed costs don't change. That's why we call them fixed costs. So even though we might make more products, in this case, we're going to be asked to make an additional 2,000 blenders, this $400,000 isn't going to change just because we make another 2,000 blenders. So keep that in mind, so we're going to come back to that. They tell us that the blenders normally are sold directly to a retailer at $20, that's a regular price. Sunbelt has an offer from Kensington Company, which is a foreign wholesaler, so since we're going to sell it outside of the country, we don't think any of our suppliers inside, or our company, customers inside the country are going to find out about it, so they're not going to ask for a discount either. So Kensington wants to buy 2,000 blenders, but they only want to pay $11, they don't want to pay the $20. Acceptance of the offer would not affect normal sales of the product, so it's not going to mess up our sales to our domestic customers. And the additional units can be manufactured without increasing plant capacity, so we don't have to add to our fixed costs. Should they do it? I mean, that's a pretty good question. Should you do that or not? Well, if you look at that, you're going, well, I don't know. You know, you're telling me it's costing me $8 to buy the product. You know, that's labor and the materials and everything. And then you're telling me the manufacturing, the fixed cost is $4. 8 plus 4, that looks like $12 to me, and I'm going to sell it for 11, sounds like I'm losing money, right? Well, that's where you have to be careful about the fixed costs, because think about it. The fixed costs don't really change, right? And remember we said, if something doesn't change between the two choices, then it's not relevant. And so, how would we set this all up in a schedule? Well, you go over, and you can see on the on page 978, they're going to go through, we have two choices. You can either reject the special order or you can accept it. That's your choices. Well, if you reject it, what are your revenues going to be? Well, if you don't sell the special order, you're going to get zero revenues, okay? If you do sell it, you're going to sell 2,000 blenders for $11 a piece, so that's 22,000. So the revenues in this case are going up, so that would be an increase to your net income. Well, what are your costs going to be? Well, you remember, we had variable cost and we had fixed cost, right? Well, the fixed costs aren't going to change between the two because in total, fixed costs are going to always stay 400,000. So we're going to ignore those. They're not relevant. The only thing we care about were those variable costs, which were $8. Of course, if we don't do the order, the costs are going to be zero because we didn't spend anything. But if we do accept the order, we're going to make 2,000 units and we're going to pay $8 a piece for the variable cost. We ignore the fixed cost because it's going to stay 400,000 no matter what case it is. So in this case, our expenses go up 16,000, so that will decrease income. But then when you net them all out, this order is actually going to increase our income by $6,000. So should we accept it? Well, as long as we know it's not going to make our current customers unhappy, and as long as we don't have to add any new capacity because we already have people in the factory that's not being used, yeah, we should. Okay, we should go through and we should accept it. So that's an analysis of a special order. If this is positive, that's going to increase your income. If it's negative, then the answer would be no. So that's learning objective one. Okay. I'm sorry, learning objective two. Learning objective three, kind of the same thing. In this case, we're looking at a make or buy decision. So the question is, should we go through and should we make a product or should we sell it? Or buy it from outside. Now, in this case, it usually has to do with if you have a company, maybe it's manufacturing, and they make one component. A good example is aerospace. You know, Boeing, when it makes its airplanes, its jetliners, it doesn't make every single piece itself. It outsources it. Over in the Valencia Industrial Center, there are a number of small, dozens of small manufacturing companies that just make one part, a landing strut or a wing brace, that are then used in aircraft manufacturing. They don't make the whole airplane. And then Boeing doesn't make all the pieces. They bring the pieces in and they do the assembly. So it's not uncommon for companies to have parts of their manufacturing process outsourced to other businesses. So in this case, we have Baron Company, and they apparently make motor scooters, and they're trying to decide, should they make their ignition switches for their motor scooters themselves, or should they buy them from somebody else? And in this case, it looks like that they've been making them. They've been making, it looks like they made 25,000 ignition switches for their motor scooters last year. So they've gone through and they've looked to see how much it cost them. Well, their materials, they spent $50,000 to make those 25,000 switches. They spent labor, $75,000, variable overhead, fixed overhead, and they spent a total of $225,000 making those 25,000 switches. And so you divide that by the 25,000 switches, that works out to be $9 a switch. So that's what it cost them to make the switches. Now they're looking at it and they've got a bid and somebody said, you know, they'll make them for them and then deliver them for a price of $8 a unit. So the question is, what should they do? Should they continue to make them themselves or should they buy them? Well, again, this looks like a slam dunk. It's costing me $9 to make a switch and I can buy it for $8. Now, what's important here is the non-financial or non-quantitative components. There's a qualitative component. A big part of it is quality control. Do they know this company can make the same switch that's as reliable as their own switch for $8? So when you're making a question about whether or not to outsource something, a very big component is quality control. You're kind of giving up quality control if you have somebody else make something for you. Same thing if you outsource things like your customer service or your tech support. That was a big thing a few years ago. Companies went through and they started moving their tech support overseas because it was cheaper. But what they found was the people overseas, first off, they weren't as familiar with the product. Their language and communication skills weren't quite as good. So when customers would call for tech support, they couldn't get as good of an experience. They didn't always get their questions answered. The other problem they ran into was now the customers, the company's customers, were being dealt with by people who weren't the employees of the company because there was an outside company who was, those tech support people were customers of employees of another company. And so maybe they weren't as vested in making sure the customers were as well treated as though the company had its own employees. So a number of companies ended up bringing the tech support back over to, oftentimes into the United States, and then also making those people employees again because they felt they had better control over the customer control, the customer experience, and just trying to make sure that the customers were more satisfied. So there's a lot of qualitative components that come into this, but we're just going to worry about the numbers or the quantitative part. So what we do is first go, our first choice is, do we make them or do we buy them? So this is our choice for making them. So let's go over and let's just put the information in about making them, right? So this is the information, drop right back in. This is off of the bottom of page 797. So the total cost is $225,000 to make the 25,000. Now the question is, what if we buy them? Okay. Well, if we buy them, do we pay any materials? No, we don't pay any materials. If we buy them, somebody else is buying the materials. So that's going to be a zero under the buy option. Same thing with the labor. That's going to be that's a saving. So if we don't buy the materials, then we save $50,000. So that's going to increase income because our expense for materials went down. Labor, we don't have labor, so again, that's a savings of $75,000 on expense, so that increases our income. Our variable manufacturing costs, we don't have that because that goes down. You know, we aren't making them, so there's no manufacturing cost with a variable cost because variable costs go up and down with production. So if production's zero, variable costs are zero, and that's a savings. The tricky part is when we get to the fixed costs, because the question is, do the fixed costs go away? If the fixed costs go away, then we'd put that there. But if the fixed costs don't go away because maybe there's a cost that we're going to have because it's fixed, so just because we're not making those products anymore, that doesn't say that the fixed cost went down, then that would not be a savings. In this particular case, they tell us, if you read the narrative, that we're going to go, if we start outsourcing, we're not going to have a fixed cost of $60,000, but our fixed cost will be $50,000. In other words, we're going to save $10,000. So $50,000 is still cost of our fixed cost. Maybe in this particular area there's a manager that we really want to keep, and so that manager is not going to be laid off if we're not making the switches anymore. They're going to be reassigned to another area, so their costs are going to stay in the company. The key is that that cost is only going to go down by $10,000, so we're only going to see a savings. Okay? And then the purchase price, of course, when we buy, we're going to have to buy them all. We're going to have to pay the $8 for the $25,000. That's $200,000. So now when we add up all the total costs to buy them, turns out to be that's actually $250,000. So in this particular case, it would cost us $25,000 more to buy the switches as opposed to continue to make them. Now if you remember before when we looked at it, we said, well, wait a minute. It's going to cost us $8 to buy them. It's costing us $9 to go through and to make them. That seems like it would be cheaper to buy them. But it's not the case. Why? Because we don't get rid of all $60,000. This $60,000 was included in the $9 per unit for the switch, right? But it didn't all go away like the variable cost. So fixed cost is where you have to be careful, because if your fixed costs don't change, oftentimes you think you're going to save the money, but it turns out you don't, because the fixed costs don't go away, and people kind of overlook that. So that's one of the reasons why it's nice to set up this analysis. So in this case, you would decide to go through and you would continue to make those. Okay. So again, it's not really hard, the math, the cost. It's knowing what to put in here and then paying particularly close attention to your fixed cost, manufacturing cost. If you have fixed costs in any of these examples and they don't tell you it's going to change, it's probably not a relevant cost. Okay. They have to tell you it's going to change. If it's fixed costs, you're going to change, because they can go up and down when you have a different choice. Then you want to get the difference. They're going to go up and down, factored in. But if they're not going to change, then they're really not relevant. They're still going to be around whether you make choice A or choice B. They talk about opportunity cost. Again, that's where you have an opportunity to do something new if you make the choice. So maybe you have a chance to do incremental revenue or to do something else. In this particular case, we're going to talk about, they tell you, if you go through and you outsource the switches and you buy them, then you have this capacity that you were using to make the switches. Now you can use that to do something else. In this case, they say you can use the release productivity capacity to generate an additional income of $38,000. Well, you have an opportunity to use the unused capacity if you take option B, and which is the that's the buy. If you buy, you could then get another $38,000 worth of revenue. Okay, so that's relevant. That's something you need to know. It's going to help you make a decision. Well, the way we treat this here, first off, you notice that we're going to have the make or buy. Okay, this is the old scenario. So in our make, we said, well, we're going to make's going to cost us $225,000. So this is from our earlier example. Well, now they say we have an opportunity cost, and the way we do that, that $38,000, that's additional income you could have in the buy option. We go through and we show that as a cost, because if we make it, we are not going to get the $38,000. And if you're not going to take advantage of it, that's a cost, a lost opportunity. And so we show this as an additional expense added to the annual cost. So this would be your cost of making the items, and then if you decided to keep making them, you're going to lose $38,000 worth of revenue potential, which is a cost that you're missing out on. Okay, so we add those two together, and that gives us our total cost. On the buy decision, again, we had said it was $250,000 to the cost of, to buy the items. The opportunity cost, we're showing it over here as an expense on the choice where we chose not to use that opportunity. And then so in this particular case, you can see now our choice is different. Because now, even though we're saving $25,000 by making the items, we're giving up $38,000 of income. And so what would happen in this particular case, if we made this choice of buy, we would see income increase by $13,000. So opportunity costs can change a situation from being not a good idea to being a good idea, assuming that you can actually use whatever's freed up by your choice to do something else that's productive. So this is taking a look at the opportunity cost in a make or buy decision. So that's objective 3, and that's over on page 980, where we show this little graph here. The next one we look at is where we have products that we're making, and we either can make them up to a certain point and then we can stop and sell them, or we can keep making them a little bit further along and then we can sell them for a higher price. It's usually in some sort of a manufacturing process. So maybe think of oil. You know, you're an oil company. You can pump the oil out of the ground and then you can refine it down to being crude oil, and then you can just sell your crude oil at a lower price to somebody who's going to refine it. Or you can take your crude oil to your refinery, and there you can turn it into gasoline and kerosene and diesel and other higher quality products that bring a higher price per barrel than the crude oil. But to do that, you've got to pay the cost of producing and refining those products from crude oil up to the gasoline and the diesel. So the question is, should you sell it at the price for the crude oil, which is lower, but you don't have as much cost, or should you incur the additional cost and then sell it at a higher price? So that's what we're talking about here. So the decision rule is you should process things as long as the incremental revenue, the extra revenue you get from going to the higher level product from the processing exceeds the incremental cost of processing it, which makes sense. It's kind of not too tricky. How do you analyze that? That's where it gets a little bit more of a challenge to put it in. Okay. So again, we have this example, and this is over on page 982. So here we have just one product, single product. We're going to do one where we have more than one product. In this case, you have a company that makes tables. And they go through, they can either make the tables that are unfinished and then sell them to somebody who's going to then apply their own finish to do-it-yourselfers, or they can go through and finish the tables. Now, if they sell finished tables, they're going to sell them for a higher price because people can just buy a table, take it home, put it in their house, and they're done. But it's also going to be a higher cost because they have to do the labor and processing and the stain and all that for the finished tables. So what should they do? Make tables that are unfinished and sell them that way? Or should they finish them off and then sell them as a finished product? Well, you look at the numbers. So in this case, the cost to manufacture an unfinished table is $35, and they can sell those $35 cost tables for $50. So they have $15 a table they make in the contribution margin. They have unused capacity, so that's good, so they don't have to add anything to continue to do the work, so it's always nice to know you can keep doing the extra steps without having to incur a lot more cost. So they go through and they say that we can use unused capacity, and they can sell them for $60, which is $10 more than the unfinished. They can sell the finished ones for $60, and then they're only going to have to increase their direct materials for $2 for like the stain, and then the labor is going to be $4. So it's going to cost them an extra $6 to process each of those tables. Okay? Variable manufacturing overhead cost will increase by $2.40, which is 60% of direct labor. There's no change in the fixed manufacturing overhead. Whether we process them or not, it's not going to add any or take anything away, so that's not relevant. And so you can see what the cost looks like. Works out to be $15 is what we have for the direct materials. Okay? Do we have that up there? Yeah, the cost to process unfinished tables is $35. So direct materials is 15, direct labor is 10, the variable manufacturing is 6, and the fixed manufacturing overhead is 4. So this is where they give us the detail for that $35,000 or $35 a table. Okay? So this is what our cost is. So that's going to be one of our choices, right? Our first choice is not to finish it. So let's put the numbers up in a spreadsheet. If we sell the unfinished tables, then we're going to get $50. Here's the $35 that we're going to incur in order to go through and to make the table. And we're going to end up with net income of $15 a table. So that's our base case. That's our what we're doing now, our status quo. The question is, should we process them further? Well, then ask yourself, how much are you going to sell it for? Well, we're going to sell it for $60, right? If we sell it for $60, then that's going to increase our sales. So that's... I wish they'd go the same way. Okay. So we're going to increase it for $60. Our direct materials, did our direct materials go up? Seems like our direct materials went up. Look at my notes here. I think we have the cost of the stain and everything. So I think that ended up going up by, how much did it go up? $2, okay, that's what I thought. Our direct labor goes up, if I remember right, I think it was $4 because we have to pay the people to do the staining. So now it goes from 10 to 14, so that was the increase of 4. Our manufacturing overhead, it went up by 60% of our direct labor, so I think that was $2.40 because this went up by $4, so 60% of $4 is $2.40. So we add $2.40 to the $6. And our fixed manufacturing overhead, in this case, because we've got it over here, but it didn't change, we're going to show it at $4 because that's the same number. So now we can go through and we're going to add all these together, and we see that it's going to cost us $43.40 to make a finished table. Well, we're going to sell it for $10 more, so if we subtract that, it turns out that the profit we're going to make, the net income on each of the tables, is going to be at $16.60. So in this case, it would make sense from a profit standpoint to sell a finished table because we'll make more profit than we will with an unfinished. And then you can go through and see the numbers, the increase here, the direct materials, that's going to be a decrease because our expenses go up, so that decreases, because this is increase or decrease in net income, so increase expense decreases our net income. More expense for labor, so that decreases income, more expense for overhead. Notice this is zero. Now, remember I said earlier, if it's not relevant, you don't have to put it up there. There's different ways to do this. Here, you want to show what the total cost is. So even though that didn't show up, it's not relevant for your decision over here, you might want to put it in just so the people can see that what the total cost is going to be. But if you put it in on one side, it doesn't change. You need to put it in on the other side. So either, if it doesn't change, either put it in both sides so it has zero effect over here, or leave it out. Just get the same result, just need to be consistent with what your demand or what your the people that are using this want to see. And then finally, you add those all up, and you see that it works out to be $8.40 increased expenses. We've got $10 of increased sales revenue, so that's our $1.60. So in this case, it would make sense to process. Okay, so that's a single case decision. Now, oftentimes, though, you go through, and they have this over on page 982, really 983, where you have more than one product. You have multiple products. That's where it gets to be tricky, right? So in this case, we have raw milk. So you'd be a dairy processing company. And so you have raw milk, and you're going to go through and process it into two products, cream and skim milk. All right, this is where you go. This is your first stop. So you get the raw milk, you process it, cream, skim milk. Now notice something here that's called joint cost. That means it costs you money to take the raw milk and turn it into these two products. But if it's a joint cost, we're not going to worry about it because we're going to assume those joint costs got incurred up to this point. We want to know whether we should go from this point of making cream or skim milk to the next step, which is making cottage cheese out of the cream and making condensed milk out of the skim milk. So we only want to know the cost of going from the first level of products that you're making to the second level that you have the chance of making. So these common costs that happen over here for the joint costs, since that doesn't affect the decision to go from here to here, we can ignore the joint cost. So joint cost, you're not really, that's, kind of think of it as a sunk cost. It's already happened, you can't control it. You had to do it to get to this point, so now we just want to worry about going from this point to that point, what are our costs going to be? All right? So, let's go through, we're going to break it into two pieces. We're going to do, I think, the cream first, and then we're going to do the milk. So the cream, they give you some information. They tell you the cream, is this the cream? Yeah. It costs $9,000 to make the raw milk into the cream and into the skim milk. But again, we're not going to worry about those because they're sunk, they're already happening. We do, though, care about the cost to take the cream into cottage cheese. It's going to cost us $10,000 per day to do that extra work. All right? Then we say, well, what are we going to get if we sell it? Well, when we sell the cream, we're going to get $19,000. Okay? That's kind of like our first tier, the first level of raw product. We can get $19,000 a day from the milk we process. If we turn it into cottage cheese, though, we're going to get $27,000 from the milk we can process in a day. So it's a pretty big increase. So the question is, should we process it or not? Well, you look at this, you can kind of see the ballpark. You go from 9 to 27, that looks like an increase of about 8,000. You're going to spend 10,000. It may not make sense, but let's put the numbers in and see what it looks like. So we go through and we say, if we don't do anything, we just make the milk, the raw milk, into our first level of products, which is the cream and the skim milk. The creams, we're going to get $19,000. There's no more money we have to spend because there's some costs have already happened. So we're going to get $19,000 a day profit from selling the milk at the cream level. If we process it further, we're going to get $27,000 to get the cottage cheese, but it's going to cost us $10,000 to go through and to process and do the extra work. So that's going to end up giving us a net profit of $17,000 a day. Well, which would you rather have, $19,000 a day profit or $17,000? Most companies would say they want the $19,000. So in this case, we're going to get more revenue, so net income is going to go up, but the expenses are also going to go up greater, and so those expenses increase more than the revenue, and that results in an unfavorable decision. So in this case, we would not process. Okay, they should not process the additional product. They should sell the items that get turned into the cream. All right. Now let's talk about the skim milk, because you have the choice. You could just sell the cream, and you could still take the skim milk and turn it into condensed milk, right? Because you don't have to. Once they get split off from the common process, they're two products, so you can kind of look at those as two separate decisions. So let's look at the skim milk. The skim milk, again, there's $5,000 for the skim milk that it cost us to go through, but it's a common cost, and we're going to ignore that because we have to do that to get the raw milk into the cream and the skim milk. So the $5,000 that gets allocated to the skim milk for the joint cost, that's a sunk cost. We're going to ignore that. The cost to process the skim milk into the newer product, the higher level product of condensed milk, that's $8,000. That's relevant. That affects our decision. The revenues, well, if we sell the skim milk, we're going to get $11,000 a day. The condensed milk, looks like a good profit on that. We could get $26,000 a day for processing that milk into condensed milk. So should we process that? Well, we do the same thing. We go through and say, well, right now, if we make the skim milk, we're going to go through and sell it. We're going to make $11,000 a day. There's no more cost to get to that point because that's where we're going to stop. But then to process it further, if we want to go into the condensed milk, well, we'll get $27,000 or $26,000 a day if we process and make condensed milk, but it's going to cost us $8,000 to go through and to turn that skim milk into the condensed milk. But you can see that the difference is we still ended up with $18,000 greater revenues over cost, and so in this case, when we look at it, it turns out to be that the revenues are quite a bit higher than the cost. And we should process the skim milk into condensed milk because that's going to give us $7,000 a day. So in this case, after we get done taking the raw milk and turning it into cream and skim milk, what we should do is we should just sell the cream then by itself. Then we should take the skim milk and continue to process it into condensed milk. So you can kind of see how we go through and we look at each, in multiple product cases, we look at each individual product after it's split off from the joint production as an individual analysis. So that's learning objective number, I think that was 4, wasn't it? Yeah, that was 4. Okay. So now we're over to learning objective 5. Now this is the last case where we talk about situations of comparing two different choices. And in this particular one, what we're trying to do is, last one is the income statement. Still learning the content in the book. This is the next to last one. This is where we have the repairing, retaining, replacing equipment. So this is actually one of the more common scenarios. In this particular case, the company is deciding to go through and replace a factory machine with a new machine, okay? So they have a machine that originally cost $110,000, so that was in the past. It has a balance and an accumulated depreciation of $70,000, so it's not been completely used up yet. The book value is $40,000, so you know, businesses go, oh, well, that machine's still worth $40,000. They're like, I can't not use that because that's money I've already spent, but it's in the past. You can't get that money back, so you really shouldn't focus on it. So that's going to be a sunk cost. Okay? Even though you can still use it for 4 years, we have to kind of ignore that. The company is considering replacing this machine with a new machine. The new machine cost $120,000. That is something that we're going to have to pay now, so that is relevant. It's expected to have zero salvage at the end of its 4-year life. If the new machine is acquired, the variable manufacturing costs are expected to decrease from $160,000 a year to $125,000. So that's why we're getting a new machine. It's cheaper to run, uses less electricity or whatever the case is. And the old unit, if we do get the new one, the old one could be sold for $5,000. You know, I mean, we think it's worth $40,000, but really it's only worth $5,000. So they want us to do an analysis, not for 1 year, but for 4 years. So how do we take all those words and put them into a schedule? Okay. So what we want to do, again, is we want to have our two choices. We want to go through and we want to look at whether we're going to keep the machine or retain the equipment or whether we're going to replace it. Those are our two choices. So let's look at those two. Again, keep in mind all this information. It's for 4 years. The new one's going to cost us $120,000. The new one's going to cost us $125,000 a year to run. The old one's going to cost us $160,000 to run. And if we do get the new machine, we can sell the old one for $5,000. So this is what it's going to look like. To retain the machine, the variable cost, the year cost every year of running the old machine is the $160,000 for 4 years, and that's the $640,000. So if we don't do anything, we keep the old machine, that's what it's going to cost us to run for the next 4 years. How about the new machine? Well, that only costs us $125,000 a year, so 4 years at $125,000 is only $500,000, so we get some savings there. How about the cost? Well, we do have to buy the new machine. It's $120,000, and that's relevant. I mean, that's something we need to think about. So that's going to be a cost we're going to factor in, but we only buy it one time, so it's not 4 years, it's just one time. And then if we get the new machine, we do get some money for the old one. We get $5,000 back. So that's actually going to reduce the cost of getting the new machine. So we put that in. So now we add all those up, and you can see in this case, to replace the old machine, is $615,000. Well, to keep the old one and keep it running is $640,000. So in this case, it turns out that the savings and the variable costs are more than enough to compensate for the increase of cost of buying the new machine. And then you also get to reduce that a little bit by the sale of the old machine. And so you actually would save $25,000 by buying the new machine. Now you say, wait a minute, what about that old machine that's there? You know, you had $40,000. Don't you have a loss for 35, because if you think it's worth 40 and you only sold it for 5, isn't that a loss? Well, for GAAP, yes, you would show on your income statement a loss of 35,000. But again, it's kind of like on the cash flow statement. There's no cash going out. And so since that cost has already happened, it's not really going to be relevant. The only thing about that old machine that's going to affect you going forward if you get the new machine is that you're going to sell it and get some cash. We ignore everything else about the old machine. It's a sunk cost. So in this particular case, should you retain it or replace it? And the answer would be, well, you should replace it, right? Because you save yourself some money. So this is probably one of the easiest analyses to go through and do in terms of incremental or differential analysis. Okay. Again, they say the book value of the old machine doesn't affect the decision. People want to put that in. That's one of the things that people always try to do. But book value is a sunk cost. We just ignore it because those costs can't be changed by future decisions. Okay. But again, if we're going to sell it or we can trade it in, that does change our current cost of buying the new machine because we get money to offset or we get a trade value. So we take into account just that trade value. All right, now the last section is where we talk about an unprofitable segment or component, division, store, and deciding whether or not we should eliminate that unprofitable segment or whether we should keep it. And this could be a product line, it could be a store, it could be a department, division. You can analyze this a lot of different ways. And usually what happens is you go through and you think, well, you know, if you're losing money on something, then it makes sense that you should just close it. But the problem is, sometimes just because you close something doesn't mean all the costs go away. It kind of comes back to those fixed costs again. And so if those fixed costs are not all going to go away, they're just going to roll over and be absorbed by the other segments, you may not be saving as much money as you think by closing out that losing segment. Okay, so how do you do it? Well, you have to go through and you have to do the comparisons, and then you have to see if you find that the segment that is going to be closed is covering some of your fixed costs, and if you just take those fixed costs and move them to other areas, it might turn out to be that even though it's unprofitable, you actually lose less money running an unprofitable division than you would by closing it. So the rule would be retain the unprofitable segment unless the fixed costs eliminated exceed the contribution margin loss. So let's go through the example. Okay. So this is again, this is on page, bottom of page 986. You got three lines. You got Pro, Master, and Champ. And they've got a contribution margin or CVP income statement for each one of those showing that the net income for Pro is a profit, their contribution margin is 280 and their net income is 200. Masters, their contribution margin is 90, and they make a profit of a net income of 40. Champ, though, on the other hand, their contribution margin is positive, but it's very small, 10,000. And because of their fixed costs, they actually end up losing money. And so if you add all three of these together, you see how the total company is doing. So people are asking themselves, well, why don't we just close this particular department or this particular segment or this product line, whatever it might be, and just keep these two? Because after all, then we'd save ourselves $20,000. Well, the question you have to ask yourself is, okay, but what happens to these fixed costs? If you don't have Champ, the sales will go away. If you don't have Champ, the variable costs will go away, because variable costs are tied to your sales volume. But will the fixed costs go away? If the answer is yes, the fixed costs will go away, then you should get rid of it. But if the answer is no, those won't go away, you have to ask, well, what happens to those? The part that doesn't go away, the fixed cost, gets allocated back over here. And that can cause one of those product lines or segments to end up losing money or having less income. So let's walk through that. So $30,000 is the amount of the fixed cost for Champ. Notice Pro has $80,000 of fixed cost, and Master has $50,000. Okay, so all together, we got $160,000. They go through and they tell us after the income of eliminating Champ, the fixed costs don't go away. In other words, they get allocated two-thirds to Pro and one-third to Master. So what we're saying is, guess what? That $30,000 doesn't go away. Maybe it's people we have that we aren't going to fire, so we're just going to move around. So we're going to split that. One-third of $30,000 is $10,000, and two-thirds is $20,000. So we're going to take and we're going to put $20,000 to Pro and $10,000 to Master. So now when we add our fixed cost up, they went from $80,000 to $100,000. Make sure I got my numbers right. And they went from $50,000 to $60,000. And they went from $50,000 to $60,000. And notice what happens is we still have the same $160,000 because we didn't get rid of the fixed cost. And now our net income is $210,000 between the two. Well, our net income before was $220,000 with the division or the segment that was losing money. Why? Because even though it was losing money, it was still bringing in sales that were high enough. Notice this, the contribution margin, the sales were higher than the variable cost. So this contribution margin of $10,000 was still money you got after having a sale that could be used to cover your fixed cost or generate a profit. So when these pieces went away, so did that contribution margin. That was helping cover these fixed costs. So if you don't have that contribution margin, then this number is going to go down by the amount of that contribution margin. And that's what we saw here. Was our profit went down by $10,000. So the whole question about what you do with the fixed cost is really the key in whether or not you get rid of an unprofitable segment. If you can get rid of the fixed cost or a portion of them, it may make sense. But if your fixed costs stick around, as long as the unprofitable segment is generating a positive contribution margin, it's probably not going to make sense to get rid of it. Okay. But how do you know? You don't really know until you plug it into the numbers. Now, this is doing it on a cost, volume, profit, income statement format, so it's kind of easy to see that. You could also do it like we were doing it, where you were doing an incremental or differential analysis. You could do what would happen if you continued. So if you continued, this is going to be the sales numbers just for Champ. So this is Champ sales. The Champ is the segment that's unprofitable. This is the variable cost, the contribution, the fixed cost. So if you go through and continue, you're going to keep losing the $20,000. If you get rid of it, the sales go away, the variable costs go away. But here's the thing, the fixed costs don't go away. So look what happens if you eliminate it. The fixed costs are here, so you actually end up losing $10,000 more to eliminate the division than you would if you kept it. So you could also do the analysis this way, and that would show you that what you should do is to keep the segment running even though you're losing money on it. It seems counterintuitive, but that's where the benefit of doing a financial analysis will make you think of things a little differently than just our gut reaction. Because oftentimes our gut reaction is to say we should do something, and it turns out because we don't factor in the fixed costs properly, we think they're going to go away because they're a cost, but they don't. We often make a bad decision, either on a buy or a make or buy decision or on eliminating an unprofitable segment. Now what happens if we can get rid of $22,000 of the fixed cost, of those $30,000? That might make sense, okay? So in this case, they say, well, you know, again, this is the old division. You know, this is champ. This is where it's at. It's losing 20,000. If we can go through, though, and we can get rid of $8,000, I'm sorry, all but $8,000, we can eliminate 22,000 of those fixed costs when we close the unprofitable segment, and now we only have $8,000 left. Well, in this case, because the $8,000 is less than the contribution margin, we actually would end up having an increase in net income. So even though sales would go down, variable costs would go away, so our profit goes up, our decrease of fixed cost of $22,000 is enough to actually make this a good decision. So if you can get rid of the fixed cost, then it makes sense to go ahead and close the unprofitable segment. But you probably won't know how that works unless you plug the numbers in and actually let them calculate themselves out. Okay? So that's learning objective 6, analyzing relevant costs to determine whether to eliminate an unprofitable segment or product. Okay? And that's pretty much everything that's in chapter 21. So again, it's not that it's tricky from the standpoint of the math. It's just two columns and take the difference. It's knowing what numbers to put in the individual columns so that you know how to do the math. I would recommend doing the homework, paying attention to the wording, going back, like I said, at the end of each learning objective, and doing those do-it exercises in the textbook, because a lot of what we do in 20 and 21 is really just trying to figure out how to take a word problem and put it into a formula or put it into a spreadsheet to do our analysis. So the tricky part's turning the words into the spreadsheet or into the formula. So good luck with that, and I hope that helped.